This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Grace to you in peace in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship at the First Presbyterian Church of Warminster, and a special welcome to those who worship with us through WRDV FM radio. Today's liturgist is Jonna, and our musical gifts are offered by Kathy Worth Bulkus on organ and piano, Frank Bulkus on flute, and our senior choir, conducted by our director of music, Dave Sathra. The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Worship begins with the sounding of the chimes. Before turning to scripture, let us pray. Gracious God, we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry for this heavenly food, that it may nourish us today in the ways of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen.
Reading from Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 through 17. Then God spoke all these words: I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. From 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 to 31. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. In order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord.
Our gospel lesson is from John chapter 2, verses 13 through 25. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Now, if you have been part of a church for any length of time, you are at least somewhat familiar with how that church's denomination is organized. And usually that plan for organization is written down as a form of government. For example, the United Methodist Church has the Book of Discipline. Roman Catholic churches are governed by canon law. And my denomination, the Presbyterian Church USA, has what is called the Book of Order. And whenever ministers, deacons, and elders are ordained and installed to serve their Presbyterian congregations, they make a vow before God to be governed by this Book of Order. Now, of course, the Book of Order or any form of church government does not hold ultimate authority in and of itself, because Jesus Christ alone is head of the church. So how churches govern themselves must be rooted in scripture, and it must obey Jesus. Now, that word order may make some of us cringe a bit. It might conjure up memories of school teachers or bosses who were so strict and inflexible that they took all the joy out of learning and working. But that word order means much more than just being super organized. I like how our Book of Order describes the purpose of the church when it says that, quote, "truth is in order to goodness." And if that sounds archaic, it is, because this phrase was composed well over 200 years ago at the founding of the Presbyterian Church in the newly formed United States. But that principle is found throughout scripture. Truth is in order to goodness. The church is not here simply to believe the truth or to preserve the truth, but to manifest the truth, to make it real in the life of the church and in the life of the world. God's truth, by necessity, must be put into action. By necessity, it must be lived out, and it must have consequences. There is no point to being the church unless it bears good fruit. This truth lies at the heart of Scripture because it lies at the heart of who God is, because it is God's nature to reveal and to manifest himself through creation, through covenants, and ultimately through Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. And the same goes for those within God's covenant community. If we are made in God's image, that means that God's words, God's promises, God's love, and God's will must become manifest through our life together. Now, I would love to say that we Presbyterians came up with that awesome idea that truth is an order to goodness, but we did not. It goes all the way back to God's covenants with Noah, Abraham, and Moses. When God gives Israel the Ten Commandments in today's lesson from Exodus, God, in effect, is forging their constitution. They no longer are Pharaoh's possession. They are now a priestly nation set apart to worship God and then to offer God's goodness to the world. Their life together will reflect the nature of God to all nations, not only in how they honor God, but also in how they treat each other. In the words of Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann, the Ten Commandments are no mere set of rules, but the proclamation of who God is and how God shall be practiced by this community of liberated slaves. In other words, truth is in order to goodness. These days, whenever we hear someone describe church as organized religion, it's usually in a criticism. Not of what we believe or who we believe in, but how the church often fails to bear the good fruit that our faith calls for. And the Apostle Paul is pointing out this failure in his first letter to the Corinthians when he hears that they have become divided over various issues in opinions and practices. And Paul tells them that whatever truth this corporate life is manifesting, it is not the truth of the gospel. And even though their response to the gospel is enthusiastic and passionate, it is still clinging to the ways of their old life, where self-preservation rather than self-sacrifice is the order of the day, and where competition threatens community. That, Paul tells them, is the truth that they're embracing, which is not the truth of the gospel, because the truth of the gospel looks nothing like what they are doing. And if one wants to know what the truth of the gospel does look like, then look at the cross of Jesus, which will always look weak and foolish to the world. But for us, it is no less than the power of God. The late New Testament scholar Fred Craddock once wrote a sermon based on today's lesson from 1 Corinthians. And in his sermon, he asks the question, why the cross? Why the cross? His sermon muses over some of the reasons why we find it easier to say no to the cross than to say yes. And one of those reasons is that deep down, many within the church are afraid that the idea of a God who suffers and a Messiah who dies in weakness isn't what will draw the world to Jesus. Rather, we think we should emphasize the strength that comes from faith if we're going to bring others into the fold of God. Too much talk about the cross is not what will grow a church, we think. We believe that success is what attracts. So then why the cross? Well, Fred Craddock doesn't offer any simple answers. Neither does Paul offer simple answers to the Corinthians. And neither should we in our own day and age. Because after all, the best response to the question can't be summed up in words. It can only be shown in how we order our lives around the truth. Craddock wrote, "Faith is not a success story. Faith is a story that says, I take up as a way of life the cross of Jesus." Yet still, why the cross? Why take the way of weakness and humility when the world looks at such things as foolish and useless and unattractive? Why is it hard to say yes to the cross? Well, let's ponder and pray over these questions over the coming week. And then let's regather next week to hear what Jesus has to say about it. Now, to him by whom the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to God be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
True.
Let us now turn our hearts to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. God of glory, we praise you for your presence in our lives and for all goodness that you shower upon your children through Christ Jesus. Especially we thank you for promises kept and hope for tomorrow, for the enjoyment of friends, the wonders of your creation, the love from our parents, sisters, brothers, spouses, and children, and for the fellowship we find in our communities of faith. God of grace, we are one with all your children, and we offer our prayers for those whom we love. We also pray for those we too often forget, for people who have lost hope, victims of tragedy and disaster. We pray for those who suffer mental anguish and those whom we name now before you in our hearts. Oh God, you are the wellspring of life. Pour into our hearts the living water of your grace, that we may be refreshed to live this day in joy, confident of your presence and empowered by your peace, through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together.
Our Father who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And now go in peace to love and serve the Lord and to love and serve our neighbors. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever.
Love.